I love all of our speakers every year, and this year is no exception. I will say that there is no speaker who I wish were my friend more, if only so that I could have a discount at all of the places that she has worked, because she spent 12 years in New York leading buying for teams at Chanel and Dior. She is now the director of women's buying, but she could probably still work out a deal for me at Martin Patrick 3. She specializes in luxury retail. She is, and this is the part where you all are going to applaud in particular, a graduate of the University of Minnesota Retail Merchandise Program. Please keep that round of applause going for Samantha Tousey.
Okay. I was like, that's not me. I was like, wait a minute. So as designers and individuals in the design sector, there are many things that influence our work. For me, as a buyer, the largest influences are my business acumen and also following my intuition. I started at the U of M actually as a pre-pharmacy major. When it came time to choose my major, I went to my guidance counselor's office, took the book, flipped through, looked at dollar signs, and decided I'm going to be a pharmacist. It's not as much money as a doctor, but you don't have to deal with the gore. Then it came time to attend class. O-chem, no thank you. My parents own an equestrian store, and I was able to attend markets starting at a young age. I love sitting in on market appointments. I would learn about the latest product. I would watch my mom make business decisions. I also lived 45 minutes from the closest grocery store. So I had a big interest in fashion because whenever we'd go home, I would say, can I please get Harper's Bazaar or Vogue for the car ride home? Fast forward 4 years. I graduated in 2009. The economy literally had just collapsed. I applied to over 60 jobs, many of which I probably wasn't qualified for, but naively, I thought I had a chance. I finally got a call back from Chanel. And when they asked me, do you live in New York? I said, yeah, of course. I immediately called my mother after hanging up the phone and I said, Mom, I need a plane ticket to New York City. I need to go tomorrow. I quickly learned that fashion people operate at a totally different level. They watch all of the shows. They follow all of the influencers. They read all of the blogs. I used to walk to work and I would walk by this gentleman on the corner of 57th and 5th. He oftentimes would take my photo. At first, I thought, oh, it's kind of cute. Old guy taking my photo. Then after a while, I was like, wait a minute. What's he doing with these pictures? Finally, one day, I said to my colleague, I said, there's this creepy old guy that keeps taking my photo. She started laughing, and she said, Sam, that's Bill Cunningham, the street style photographer of the New York Times. There were many weeks when I didn't make it into the street style edition. But on the weeks when I did, I was really giddy. At the time, the Sunday paper cost $6. I couldn't afford that. So I'd run to Starbucks. I'd borrow their coffee. I'd see if I made it. If I did, I'd buy it. And if not, I'd put it back. I mean, of course. A lot of people think that buying is going to fancy shows, picking out pretty clothes, attending lots of cool parties. But in all actuality, 90% of my time is actually spent here. Wah, wah. Yeah, that's right. I spend the majority of my time in Excel because at the end of the day, buying really is making bets. And you try to crunch the numbers as much as possible to try to get it right. But buyers don't have crystal balls. So as much as we hope that nothing goes to markdown, sometimes things do. I'll take you through a few bets that paid off in my career. It was 2017. We all gathered in Paris to watch Maria Grazia Chiuri send her spring-summer 2018 collection down the line. I instantly got excited when I saw this handbag. It was cool. It was different. It was like unlike anything I'd seen on the market. My gut was telling me I needed to buy as many as possible. Then it came time to actually buy it. They said, oh, due to production limitations, you can only purchase 300. In 2021, Dior went on to sell over 20,000 units in the Americas, and they still couldn't keep up with demand. Another bet that paid off in my career was this Ultramat story. Again, it was different. It was cool. I had this feeling in my gut that it was going to be really big. All the other buyers looked at it and they said, it's not feminine. It's too expensive. It's not the Dior client. But I knew deep down that we could sell this. It went on to be an exclusive for the United States. It achieved a 95% sell-through, which essentially means it sold out. The next season, Dior brought it back. All of the other countries bought it, and it's still part of the Dior Core program today. I started my retail career working part-time in college at Bloomingdale's at the Mall of America. Yeah, I'm like, that's not a pretty picture. And I quickly realized the assortment wasn't good. My family would travel, and whenever we would travel, I'd say, can I please go to the mall? Because I knew the assortment would be better. Fast forward to my first buying job at Chanel. I learned that just like in school, each store gets a grade, A to D. The majority of the stores in the Midwest, they get a D. If they're lucky, maybe a C. So if you're ever wondering why there's teddy bear sweaters or watered down assortments in the Midwest, this is why. I always had a soft spot for the Midwest. And when it comes to choosing the assortment and the allocation, it's based on sales. And if you didn't give these stores more products, how could they prove they could do more sales? If you didn't give them the fashion merchandise, how could they prove that they could sell more? Following COVID, my husband and I decided not to return to New York. I knew that I wanted to do something meaningful in the Midwest because the desire for fashion is here. So many people would come up to me and they'd tell me these wonderful stories about Dayton's and the Oval Room. I knew that the desire for fashion ran deep. The stars aligned, and Martin Patrick III had just launched their women's department. And unlike working at other large corporations, at Martin Patrick III, the store doesn't get a D allocation. Instead, I've been able to build on their vendor matrix and bring in other brands that you'd only find in major retail cities. My next challenge is not actually a design challenge, but rather overcoming the challenge of people thinking there's no place for women to buy luxury goods in the Twin Cities. Now, as I reflect on this, I'm taking the sales data that I'm learning from the Midwest and combining that with my past experiences. Since the women's department is only 3 years old, I have to lean a lot on my intuition and follow my gut to build this department. The next time you're in the North Loop, I encourage you to stop by the store and see all the excitement that we are creating. Thank you.